Hello, friends. Happy Tuesday. Welcome to Music and Storytime with Family Equality and Linz from Queer Kid Stuff. We're so excited that you're with us today. As you can see on your screen, today is a really special day. It's a day of action. You can see it's scrolling LGBTQ Families for Black Lives. So today is a day of action that we're taking at Family Equality with LGBTQ families all across the country to show up for Black communities, for Black folks in our lives, and also in our institutions and our systems to show that we as queer folks value and demand justice and a better life for the Black people in our lives and our communities. So you can check out our website and our Facebook page for more information on that. But we have activities for the whole entire family, zero to 102. There are things for you to engage with, actions for you to take, and things to keep you busy, not just today, but for days to come. And during our special time with Linz, which we're about to kick off, we're going to be doing some story, some singing, some crafting, and just really celebrating the day and getting us excited about taking action. So without further ado, I'll hand it over to Linz from Queer Kids Stuff.
Thanks, Jess. All right, let's get started. It's okay to be gay. We are different in many ways. Doesn't matter if you're a boy, girl, or somewhere in between. We all are part of one big family. Gay means happy. Queer Kid Stuff. You are enough here at Queer Kid Stuff. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining me again for Music and Storytime. I'm Linz. I'm the creator and host of Queer Kid Stuff, where I make LGBTQ plus and social justice videos for all ages. I also host a podcast called Activist You, where I interview inspirational kid and youth activists. They are truly incredible. Go check them out. And I also do performances like this all over the internet. And when we're not in quarantine, all over the country, you can check out my upcoming events on my website, queerkidstuff.com. Quick announcements that we have a family celebration, a family pride celebration coming up that Queer Kid Stuff is teaming up with a bunch of your favorite LGBTQ plus children's performers and entertainers and authors, some incredible, incredible folks that we're teaming up with for a pride celebration this Sunday. So check that out at queerkidstuff.com. It's called Pride-a-palooza. I'm so stoked to be producing that. And then we also recently launched a remote learning program. It's kind of like a social justice 101 for kids. It's an 8-week course with lots of printable PDFs and downloads and tons of activities based on your favorite Queer Kid Stuff videos. But today, that's it for the announcements. But today we are celebrating LGBTQ families for Black lives. And this is something that is so, so important because we wouldn't have the LGBTQ plus movement and the rights that we have today without Black queer people, Black queer and trans people. So that's what I want to focus on a little bit today. We're going to talk a little bit about privilege. That's something that's important, I think, for me as a white person to be talking to people about. And for all of us to kind of be recognizing our privilege, even as queer people in this movement, and where we can help our Black siblings. So we're gonna read a story as well, written by Black queer parents. And we're gonna do a little craft, we're gonna sing a song, and then we're gonna celebrate Pride together. All right, so I wanna talk a little bit about privilege. So this is something that we talk about a lot on Queer Kid Stuff. Actually, I have a whole series on identity and privilege and intersectionality. I really, really encourage you to go check out that playlist. It's over just on the Queer Kid Stuff YouTube channel. And something we talk about, and there's a really easy way to talk about this with kids. It's not such a complex idea about, you know, some people based on their identity and the different parts of their identity are treated more fairly than others. And to get into this song where we kind of talk a little bit about privilege, I want to know what your favorite thing to do in the playground is. So let me know. If you have a favorite activity you like to do when you're in the playground, I know when I was a kid, I loved to go on the swings. You could go up and down. It felt like you were soaring through the air. I loved going on the swings. There's so many awesome things that you can do when we're not in quarantine and we can go to the playground. You can go on the slide. You can go, what else, in the sandbox. They all have those like cool climby things that you can do now. Playgrounds are a lot cooler than when I was a kid. And they have the monkey bars. So let's talk about the monkey bars. The monkey bars can be kind of tough, right? I always had trouble with the monkey bars when I was a kid. And I think that the monkey bars can be really difficult for some people where swings are definitely where it's at, Anna. But the monkey bars are tough sometimes, especially, you know, if you're a kid who grows a little bit taller than the other kids, you can just reach up when you're just standing there, right? Where the other kids have to swing and have to have some arm strength, right? So we're gonna talk a little bit about how the swings are kind of like, or sorry, the monkey bars. The monkey bars are kind of like privilege. Sometimes when you're at the park playing, you find some of the other kids saying, "Look, see, the monkey bars are free." You watch the other kids swing by with ease, but you can't reach. You sit there thinking, "That's not fair. There's nothing more I could have done to prepare for this challenge. Just need to be taller." And that's what privilege is. Could be money, could be that. With privilege is that when we recognize it and we see it and we see it in ourselves and we see it in other people, that's when we can change things and we can make things more equal, more just, more fair for everyone else. And I think that's something we all want for our friends and our family and for those folks who aren't treated as fairly as us, especially as speaking to white and non-black people of color as well. All right. We are going to read a story, and you probably have not read this book before, so I'm excited to introduce it to all of you. So this is a book called Umi and Uma, and it is, I believe, independently published by Naisha and Samantha Davis Williams, and they are married moms with a baby named Abigail. So I met them when I was living in Brooklyn, and they were so, so lovely, and I was so happy that they were able to give me their wonderful, wonderful book. So Umi and Uma, the story of two moms and a baby. All right. And I have an inscription. Isn't that cool? Because they gave it to me. Here we go. All right. Beautiful illustrations. It was a snowy winter night in Brooklyn, New York. Grandma was home for the holidays, and she was in the kitchen making a cup of tea. "Abigail, it's time for bed," she said. "Okay, Grandma." Abigail ran to the bathroom to brush her teeth, grabbed her favorite purple pajamas, and jumped in bed with excitement. "Grandma, I'm ready for my bedtime story," she yelled with a smile. Abigail loved Grandma's bedtime stories because she never read them from a book. It was Grandma's crazy way of sharing her family's history. Okay, Abigail, just one story and then lights out, little one, Grandma said. Once upon a time, in the land of Astrin, there lived Umi and Uma. Umi loved to spend her time in the forest. She enjoyed archery, horseback riding, and camping. Uma loved to dance, take care of the animals, and spend time with the people of the village. Think about what you like to do and what your parents like to do. Umi and Uma loved each other so much that they do everything together. Went on travel adventures, hiked up mountains, swam in the ocean, and made campfires. The land of Astrin was their favorite place to be because everyone was happy, and the mother of the village loved them all equally. Many years passed, and even though the land of Astrin was the perfect place to be, Umi and Uma believed something was missing. The people of the village in Astrin were all a big family, but Umi and Uma were ready to build a small family of their own. One day, while taking a walk, Umi and Uma passed two village kids and their parents. At that moment, Umi told Uma, "Let's have a baby." Uma smiled and said, "Yes, let's have a baby." After a few months passed by, Umi had a special surprise for Uma. While cooking dinner, Umi gave Uma fresh flowers from the garden. Inside the flowers, there was a note. "We're having a baby." Uma was so happy she began to cry. Umi and Uma were excited to begin their 9-month adventure before the baby arrived. While shopping for clothes for the baby, a woman asked them if they had a doula. "What's a doula?" Umi asked. "A doula is someone who takes care of a woman when she is carrying a baby. She massages her body, makes her tea, and keeps her happy during her 9-month adventure," the doula responded. "Wow, that sounds great," Umi said. Every month, Umi's stomach got bigger and bigger as they got everything ready for the baby. They were so excited, they dreamed of one day hiking with their baby, swimming with their baby, and even going horseback riding with their baby. Ooh, that sounds like fun. One day, when Umi was folding their baby clothes, she saw a pool of water below her feet. She was so excited it was time for them to meet the baby. They arrived at the village birth house to meet their doula and the village doctor. Umi was in a lot of pain, so their doula remained by their side. It hurts a lot to have a baby. After many hours, their baby finally arrived. Everyone was so happy. Her skin was the color of chocolate, and she had a tiny nose just like Umi. They named her Abigail. She filled their hearts with so much joy. From that moment, their family felt complete. That's the story of Umi, Uma, and Baby. "I'm Baby," Abigail said loudly. "Yes, yes you are, and now this baby will close her eyes and go to sleep," Grandma replied with a smile. "Good night, Grandma," Abigail said softly. "Good night, Abigail," Grandma said, and turned off the light. The end. Isn't that a lovely story? So that's Umi and Uma, the story of two mommies and a baby. And I also want to read a little bit from this book. This is called Rainbow Revolutionaries, 50 LGBTQ plus people who made history. This is a brand new book. I think I've read from it before on this live stream. It's written by Sarah Prager, who is a white person, but I wanted to show you this book because it has incredible, like, mini biographies of some awesome LGBTQ plus folks throughout history. And I wanted to spotlight a couple of Black queer people who are featured in the book. So let's talk about Bayard Rustin first. Let's talk about three of these people. Bayard Rustin. So this is Bayard Rustin. And he lived from 1912 to 1987 in the United States. Everybody see? There we go. You've heard of Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King Jr., right? Well, did you know that 13 years before Rosa refused to change her seat on that bus, there was someone else doing the same thing? and that Martin had a lot of help behind the scenes. Bayard Rustin was one of the Freedom Riders, a group of black and white people who disobeyed the segregation laws on Southern buses by riding together in the front, which was reserved for white people only. They were arrested and beaten for what they did, but they knew defying the unjust law was the right thing to do. In 1948, Bayard traveled to India to learn about the nonviolence of Mahatma Gandhi and became convinced this strategy was the best way for the U.S. civil rights movement to succeed. He believed in it with all his heart. He was also Quaker. I went to a Quaker high school and I learned about Bayard Rustin there because he's Quaker and they also believe in nonviolence. Although violence sometimes is definitely relevant sometimes. The movement's leaders through nonviolent tactics might seem weak and didn't want to try them, but Bayard kept doing what he thought was right. He got arrested all the time for refusing to follow unfair laws, but that didn't stop him. Bayard eventually became the trusted advisor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and Bayard convinced Martin that nonviolence was the way to go. It was a huge win. Bayard was a lead organizer of the 1963 March on Washington, where Martin told the crowd of 250,000 people of his dream. Bayard spoke at that march too, and made the cover of Time magazine. Lots of people march on Washington now, but nothing like this had ever been accomplished before 1963. With racial and police tensions high, Bayard pulled off an amazing feat by keeping the march peaceful. At the age of 65, Bayard finally met his life partner, Walter Nagel. Walter and Bayard became activists for LGBTQ plus civil rights for the rest of their lives. When President Barack Obama awarded Bayard the Presidential Medal of Freedom in 2013, after Bayard had passed away, Walter was there to receive it for him. Did you ever make the choice to stand up for what you believe in no matter what? So that's the story of Bayard Rustin. I also wanted to, let's talk about some other people. Let's talk about, let's see, where is she? Let's talk about Marsha P. Johnson. We've talked about her before on this thing, but on this live stream. But we're going to talk about her again because she's so, so important to the LGBTQ plus movement. So this is Marsha. It's my friend Marsha. Marsha P. Johnson lived from 1945 to 1992. Marsha was a bright light of Greenwich Village in New York City. She lit up everywhere she went with her big smile and kind personality. She often dressed up with flowers in her hair and fun outfits. Everyone loved Marsha and she loved everyone. One time, Marsha was down to her last $2 and she used it to buy a box of cookies. She gave out all the cookies to others on the street, not leaving any for herself. She knew what it was like to be hungry. And she cared about helping anyone in the same situation, even if she was hungry herself. Marsha, who was the 1969 Stonewall Rebellion, and maybe even helped start it, was really close friends with someone named Sylvia Rivera. We've talked about Sylvia Rivera too. And the two of them saw their trans community struggling. So many young trans people in New York City were homeless, and Marsha and Sylvia wanted to give them a place to be safe off the streets. Whenever they got a hotel room, they would sneak kids in, up to 50 people in two hotel rooms at a time. That's a lot of people in a hotel room. In 1970, they raised the money to rent a four-bedroom apartment they called Star House. There was no heat or electricity to start out, but it was more than many who stayed there had had since they'd left their homes. Marsha and Sylvia worked hard to get enough money to keep Star House open, and they were the very first group to work to help trans homeless youth in New York City. Marsha is remembered as an important activist for the LGBTQ plus community and a loving mother figure for many. All right, I think we've got time for one more. Let's see who else we can talk about. Let's talk about... Let's talk about Ricky. This is someone I had never heard of before I picked up this book. We're going to talk about, here we go. This is, I believe this is how you pronounce their name, Tsepo Ricky Nocito. Sorry if I butchered that. So Ricky lives in Botswana and was born in 1987 and is still alive today in Botswana. Ricky didn't just change her own life on December 12th, 2017. She changed the lives of many more. On that day, a high court in her country of Botswana ruled in her favor in a historic case, but we'll learn more about that later. Before she was making history, Ricky was an energetic, fashion-loving child playing house in rural southern Botswana. Playing the part of the mommy, raising the curiosity of those around her because she had been assigned male at birth, she loved to steal her grandma's food to pretend to cook and play with makeup and high heels. When she moved to the capital, Gaborone, her kindergarten teachers called her parents in for a meeting to tell them there was something wrong with their son, who kept asking to be called a girl. It took until middle school for Ricky's transition to be respected. Her family got on board, and a supportive teacher encouraged her. In high school, Ricky still had to wear the boys' uniform, but she dressed it up with bangles and wore makeup. It wasn't until she saw Oprah's special on Jazz Jennings on TV that she realized there was a word for who she was. Trans. One day in 2010, Ricky lost her Botswana national ID card. For someone else, getting it replaced would have been a routine inconvenience. However, when Ricky went to get it replaced, she was told that because the lost ID said she was male and she presented as female, they couldn't give her a new one. This inconsistency around her sex on this little piece of laminated paper would turn into a years-long legal battle. Ricky just wanted her new ID. She needed it for important things like getting a job. But to get it, she needed to hire a lawyer and take on the entire government of Botswana. The case became about much more than Ricky's ID. It would go on to affect trans rights in all of Africa. If Ricky won, it would mean no trans person in Botswana would have to go through this ordeal again. And in 2017, she won. There was one thing left to do that her new female ID opened the door to. Get married! Ricky happily wedded her love, Beltany Kanza, in 2018 in Botswana. Always the fashionista, she designed her wedding dress herself. This is just the beginning of her life story and of the struggle for trans rights across her continent. So again, that is Rainbow Revolutionaries, 50 LGBTQ plus people who made history. So lots of people you might not have heard of in there. So I loved learning about Ricky. Okay, so we're gonna do a quick craft while I sing maybe two more songs. So we're gonna make protest signs. So what you're gonna wanna do is grab a piece of cardboard, preferably one that doesn't have something on it, but that's okay too. And Sharpie or markers. You could even do collage on your protest sign if you want to. This is the protest sign that I made. And this is something that you can take with you to protest. You can give it to someone who you know who's going to a protest, or you can even just put it up on your window so the people who are walking by your apartment can see. So I wrote on my protest sign, Black Trans Lives Matter, and I took this to a protest with me. So if there's something that you want to put on your protest sign, I'm gonna sing a song, and hopefully while you're figuring out what you wanna put on your protest sign, and I hope it inspires you to put something on there. I really encourage you to make your own protest sign. You can make a rainbow flag on it. You can make the trans flag on it. You can say Black Lives Matter, Black Trans Lives Matter, whatever you like, whatever you want to shout out to the world about what's going on right now. You could even put LGBTQ plus families for Black Lives. I think that would be a great one to put on a protest sign too. All right. So we're gonna sing a little protest song while you're making your protest signs. And I've done this on here before. It's a classic protest song. Sing along if you know the words. How many times must I think that those lyrics just are so, so relevant right now. Ooh, Georgie liked it, I guess. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm going to sing one last song so we can celebrate Pride together. If you're still working on your protest sign, don't worry about it. No rush. You can keep working on those as long as you want. Also, family equality, just let us know in the comments. Making protest signs is a part of their toolkit for LGBTQ plus families for Black Lives. So go check that out. Make sure that you go and see that toolkit. But we're going to sing about Pride for the last song. And then I'm going to leave you to the rest of your day. Tuesday, the last Tuesday of Pride Month. Is that true? My goodness. Thank you so much for joining me. It's been lovely. I hope you all have a wonderful protest sign. I'm so excited to see those all on Instagram and through the toolkits. But thank you so much for having me again. I'm Lindsay, the creator and host of Queer Kids Stuff, and host of Activist U, and doing lots of performances all over the internet right now. And check out our Social Justice for Kids remote learning project. You can check all of that out at queerkidsstuff.com. So thank you so much. Jess?
Yeah, thanks so much. I didn't have any cardboard, but I was able to print this awesome color.
I love it.
Sheet. So that's also a part of our toolkit. There's a few coloring sheets in there, and they make awesome signs to go in your window, like Lynn was saying. They're kind of the perfect size. Definitely check that out. We'd love to show Lynn some love. You can tip them on their Venmo. Thanks so much for sharing songs and stories with us today. And also teaching us about those rainbow revolutionaries and people that have been so integral in what we celebrate during Pride Month. And like you said, this is the last Tuesday of Pride Month. Oh my goodness.
Oh my goodness.
It's been flying by, but you can you can continue your celebration of Pride and of LGBTQ Families for Black Lives Day of Action on Family Equality's Facebook page and website. Also, definitely check out Queer Kids Stuff Pride-a-palooza this Sunday. It's going to be a blast and kind of the perfect way to close out Pride Month. And if you're at home this summer, you know, thinking, what can I do? Queer Kids Stuff and Lindsay's remote learning on social justice is just an awesome, awesome toolkit. We're excited to use it at our house. And I really encourage folks to go take a peek at it because I think it's the perfect way to spend the summer. thanks everyone for being here. Happy Pride. I hope you all take lots of action today. And we'd love to see your protest sign. Share pictures on social media.
Yeah.
We'd love to see what you came up with. So thanks so much, everyone. Have a good day.
Bye, everyone.